This evening on The Rock Newman Show, Arch Campbell, the DMV's preeminent entertainment reporter, talks about interviewing the world's biggest celebrities, his passion for giving back to the community, and surviving colon cancer. That's coming up right now on The Rock Newman Show. Good evening. Welcome to The Rock Newman Show from the campus of historic Howard University, located in the nation's capital. I'm Rock Newman, and it is my desire to inspire you with personal stories of extraordinary achievement. It was 1974, and Arch Campbell stepped in front of the camera to give his first movie review. It was for American Graffiti. Since then, he has become Washington's most visible movie and entertainment critic. 10 months ago, he retired after a 40-year career that included 8 Emmys, a Washingtonian Man of the Year Award, and D.C. Mayor Arts Award. And he joins us now, my brother from another mother.
Yes, sir.
How are you, Arch?
Always, well, I loved coming over here to see you, Rock, because I finally remember the days when you would come over to visit George Michael when I was at Channel 4, and you always chewed on George, and there was nothing he could do because he needed you, because he needed that access to Riddick Bowe, and I just loved it. And so, you know, You are my brother from another mother, and I'm happy to see you again. You came back to town.
Yes, indeed, came back to my roots.
Well, here
and
you go.
I could not be happier.
It's hard to leave D.C.
I'm telling you.
It's hard
you,
to leave.
I'm telling
I
you.
Thought I would live in D.C. 3 years.
Yeah.
And that was 41 years ago.
You know,
41 years.
We can start anywhere, but you mentioned a name.
Ah.
You mentioned George Michael. And for those tenderfoots out there who might not understand, George Michael was George Michael of WRC, the NBC affiliate here in Washington, D.C. for a long span of time. He
30 years.
And the entire crew at NBC were rock stars of media. It was Jim Vance. It was Doreen Gensler, Arch Campbell.
Bob Ryan.
Bob Ryan, the meteorologist. And this was before so many different ways that we could get the news.
Here's the thing that happened, and it's extraordinary, and I am really happy that I could be there to be a part of it. People have forgotten, number one, how important television news used to be. Now there's all kind of other stuff people can watch. But in the 70s, everybody watched the local TV news.
Yeah.
And when I came to Channel 4 back in 1974, everybody watched Channel 9. Nobody watched Channel 4. Mm-hmm. The engineers in the control room would turn
Don't
their
say
back
it. Don't
when we
say
went
it.
On the air. That's how low our ratings were. Am I getting a laugh? We have cameramen here. This is really wonderful. And the station struggled and struggled. And one of the things that a television station needed to make their news click was a sportscaster.
Yeah.
And Channel 4 did not have a sportscaster. The greatest sportscaster of the 70s in this town was Warner Wolf.
Warner Wolf.
Let's Warner
go to
left.
The videotape.
And they thought it was the end of the world. They got an even more talented guy. They got Glenn Brenner.
Yes.
And so Channel 4 was struggling, and our general manager, a guy named John Rohrbeck, went to New York, found George. George was doing rock and roll radio on WABC, and he was doing sports on the weekend on Channel 7. Yeah. He was one of the first keys to Channel 4 becoming a legacy station.
Yeah.
They called it a legacy station. That happened in 1980. The same time in 1980, Willard Scott used to do the weather on Channel 4. Mm-hmm. People would watch because Willard was so, and during the ratings, he would take off his toupee and throw it at the camera.
That's right.
You know, he did all kind of crazy stuff.
Willis Scott came up with the Smuckers 100-year-old birthday
celebration. By the way, Willard now, you know, many years have passed. Willard's kind of getting up there. In fact, the other day he announced his own birthday. Ha ha ha. But they've already told me not to bang on the table.
In case y'all didn't get that, we just said he did the Smucker's 100th birthday, and Arch claims that he announced his own 100th birthday.
Willard is about 100 now. He announced his own birthday. But I digress. Yeah. Willard left town to go to the Today Show.
Yeah.
And they had this guy up there, Bob Ryan, who had a big fat contract that he had to burn off. So they brought him, and suddenly they put together a group of us, me, Vance, Willard Scott, Bob Ryan, George Michael, and we worked together for 35 years.
Yeah.
I don't think it'll ever happen again. I don't think people will work at one television station for 30 years again, but never again will a group of four start together and work so long together. Only Vance is there now.
Vance is there, and Vance sat in that chair.
I would have loved to have seen that.
A few months ago, and what an incredible story that man has.
What did he tell you that surprised you? Whew.
Vance was so ultimately forthcoming.
Right.
With all of his trials and tribulations.
Yes.
He was extraordinarily forthcoming. I asked him about growing up, and he talked about a grandfather who mm-hmm. gave him a sense of pride and work ethic.
Right.
It really sort of revealed what drove him, his inspiration.
Mm-hmm.
And Arch, you having been such a giant in this community for so long,
I know you laugh at those
kind of terms, but I want to go back with you
and
talk about your upbringing. What brought you into this field of work? Where you were? We want to know everything about Arch Campbell, all the legal stuff at least.
I grew up in San Antonio, Texas, mm-hmm. which is a very, very, very unusual city. I believe it is totally unique and not like any other place in the country, because in the 50s when I was growing up, San Antonio was heavily Hispanic. It was full of people in the military, so mm-hmm. there were a lot of people coming and going from all parts of the country.
Mm-hmm.
It had rednecks.
Mm-hmm.
It had cowboys. It had a vibrant black community.
Mm-hmm.
It had a little bit of everything.
Okay.
And my father was a very unusual guy. He was everything except successful.
Mm-hmm.
He played piano.
Okay.
Played piano all night long. What my real aspiration was to be a piano player. Didn't have the talent. One of the things my father did for me is when I was a small kid, I was afraid of the dark.
Mm-hmm.
So he brought a radio into my bedroom and he said, look, I'm going to turn this on. You listen to it until you go to sleep.
Right.
And he put a station on, KMAC, and they played a mix of music right before Elvis.
Uh-huh.
It was like 1954, early
okay.
55.
Okay.
They played Louis Jordan. They played Eartha Kitt.
Mm.
They played, Artie Shaw. They played this kind of music that sort of implanted in me. And that there gave me my musical taste.
Let me ask you a question.
Yes.
That's what I'm here to do.
Well, it's your show.
That's what I'm here to do. You just mentioned Eartha Kitt.
Right.
How old were you when he gave you this?
Eight, nine.
8 years old. Okay.
So I interviewed Eartha Kitt, by
did
the
you
way.
Hear,
I met
did,
her.
Did you hear at that time
uh-huh.
Eartha Kitt do Santa Baby? Do you remember?
I'm trying to remember what I heard. I think I remember Santa Baby. I think the other song I remember her singing is... I don't know, some kind of a real sexy romantic thing.
I asked you about Santa Baby because I was wondering if that gave you any sort of visions of Christmas from when she did, because she did a real special number.
Oh
on
yes, I remember Santa Baby. I interviewed her. She came to Kennedy Center several times.
Mm-hmm.
Would walk around the town. One time she went out on the ledge of the terrace at Kennedy Center and stood on her head on the ledge. She was big on standing on her head. And a couple of times, and this was a long time ago, this was 30 years ago.
Okay.
She was playing racquetball, and she said, baby, call me, and look, we'll go down and we'll play a game of racquetball. Okay. I think she was hitting on me, but I wasn't smart enough to know. So I called her one morning about 7 o'clock. I said, Bertha, let's go play racquetball. She says, baby, I'm down for the count. Never heard from her again.
At a little small place on Connecticut Avenue in what would have been about 1976.
Yeah.
I see a little sign out on the marquee say Eartha Kitt. And often as I, you know, would be found, I didn't have much to do. So I parked somewhere there on Connecticut Avenue and went in. I didn't drink or anything. So it was a little small place.
Kind
it might have been
Woodley Park or DuPont Circle.
Further down, like by Florida Avenue.
Yeah.
So a little place, you know, down, we had to walk down the stairs. Yeah. So I go in there.
Was it the one step down?
You wanted to. Wasn't many.
No, I mean, there was a place called the One Step Down.
Maybe. I don't remember the name of the club. I just remember Eartha Kitt and this in this incident that I must share with you. So I go in, and as I started to do as a child, when musical acts would come out near my home in Brandywine, Maryland, at one of the Chitlin Circuit places, Wilmot's Park, James Brown and all, man, I'd go crazy. I'd get into it. You know, I'd get all into it. So Eartha was singing, and I'd be like, yeah, go on with it. And so I was sitting like right up front, and Eartha came over at one point and stood right before me, sort of eye level, and I didn't know what she was going to do, but she took her right foot and put it on my shoulder.
She was very supple,
and that was a very as a 24-year-old bachelor, that was a very special moment. Okay.
You know, she says she went to the White House during Vietnam and and complained, protested to LBJ, and she says that they that blackballed her for a decade. I don't know. She came back from that.
She did after a while, but she was. They put her in purgatory for a good while.
They did. I think I would hear her singing "Teach Me Tonight." On the radio. Just remember that radio. And I do have a story about San Antonio, Texas, because one of the guys I really loved in town was a revered teacher here at Howard named Al Freeman Jr. And I don't know if you remember Al Freeman Jr.
Do I ever played Malcolm X?
He played
Elijah Muhammad in the movie Malcolm X.
Did a lot of movie work, did a lot of television work, came to Howard, taught here for more than 20 years. He was the voice of Channel 32, did all of the station breaks, and he lived on a boat over on the waterfront.
On the
every
Potomac,
year, he said, I'm going to raise my anchor and sail out of here. He was from San Antonio, Texas. And I was talking to him about learning about music on this station, KMAC. He says, I worked there, kid. You were listening to me.
Wow.
So there you are. How's that for a connection?
And so, and it played general market music at that time, but
It was a mix, and it was a mix of white artists and R&B, and it had a lasting effect on me. I really liked the music prior to rock and roll. Not big band, but I really liked the jazzy stuff.
So what got you into television?
I didn't know what I wanted to do. I wanted to be a piano player, couldn't play piano. I signed up for a photography class. And me and another kid in high school, we were going out around the school looking for nice pictures. The principal caught us and threw me out of the class because we didn't have a pass. So, you know, the hall pass did it. So I took a speech class, and I had a teacher that took an interest in me. And the annual talent show came around, and me and another friend tried out as a two-man comedy team. And the drama teacher came up to me afterwards and said, kid, you stink.
Yeah.
You're not going to be in my show. But then she turned to me, she said, but you, I want you to MC the show. So I worked with this woman at 17 years old. We'd meet every morning, and she and I wrote up a script and typed it up, and it was one of the first really adult situations I was ever in. She left to start a radio television program at a junior college in San Antonio, and I followed her. And from there, I got jobs in radio stations, and one thing led to another.
Were you doing straight reporting then, or any kind of comedy, or?
Announcing, uh-huh. You know, just disc jockey.
That golden DJ, throat thing.
DJ stuff.
Mm-hmm.
I went to
school. What was your handle?
Easy Arch.
Okay.
Easy Arch. And then as the 70s, Easy Arch, I'm not much to look at, but I kiss hard. I'm getting another laugh out here.
Okay.
This is amazing.
Okay.
You know, they switch television. All the other stations, yeah. The cameras are robotic. Yeah. You got nobody to play to. This is great. Well, I have a friend on the crew. Anyway.
Yes.
Yeah. Easy Arch.
So you played music.
Played music.
What was your favorite music?
As I say, I really like the really unusual jazz stuff. The Ellington, the Louis Jordan. I had a show on News Channel 8, mm-hmm. and I kind of sneaked the kind of music I liked in there. I liked R&B in the 60s, mm-hmm. loved the...
Anybody stand out significantly as a favorite?
I will think of it on the way home.
Mm-hmm. Mail it back. Sure. Mail me the answer.
But, you know, Al Green.
Yeah.
I just loved Al Green.
Yeah.
So that kind of stuff. Mm-hmm. Al Green, Ellington, Louis Jordan, mm-hmm. this odd mix of stuff. Mm-hmm. Stuff from the 30s, Fats Waller.
Yeah. You moved... Did you move from San Antonio to D.C., or where were you before you came to D.C.?
I was in Dallas, Texas. Mm-hmm. I worked at a television station in Dallas, and that's really where I learned how to be on TV. And I tried to get a job. I really wanted a job in L.A. Mm. I wanted to move to L.A. Okay. And I came, I applied in New York and in Chicago. I applied everywhere. Except Channel 4.
So while you were applying, had you gone into the entertainment reporting?
Yes.
Mm-hmm. Okay.
I was working in a newsroom in Dallas mm-hmm. in 1973, and this was one of those times when the management completely turned over.
Yeah.
So they brought a guy in who later became a legend in the business, a guy named Marty Haig. And he started firing people right and left. Okay. And he was a crazy man. He would come in, scream and yell at us every morning, look at the assignment board and says, this stinks.
Yeah.
What the hell is this? That kind of thing. Mm-hmm. One morning he came in, and you know, as soon as he came in, it was like Darth Vader. The whole place went silent. He says, I want a movie reviewer.
Yeah.
Who wants to do it?
Yeah.
And the other thing my father gave me was an appreciation for movies and classic movies.
Mm-hmm.
And as they came on in the 50s, he would say, I saw this movie, It's a Wonderful Life.
Mm-hmm.
You should watch this.
Okay.
I saw this, Casablanca. Watch this.
Okay.
Here's Citizen Kane. They're going to show it tonight. You should watch this. Mm-hmm. I remember watching this. So I loved the movies anyway. And in the early 70s, one of the things that went on is they were bringing back the old movies.
Mm-hmm.
There was something called repertoire.
Mm-hmm.
Where you would go and you would see a couple of Humphrey Bogart movies, you would see a couple of Hitchcock movies. So the guy comes in and says, I want a movie reviewer. Place goes silent. You could hear a pin drop.
Mm-hmm.
I said, I'll do it.
Mm-hmm.
So that's how I got to be the movie reviewer. Mm-hmm. And the movie that had just opened that week was American Graffiti, which, as it turns out, it was sort of one of the touchstones of my generation of people who love movies. It was the first movie to really use music as a character.
Mm-hmm.
It was the first movie that really touched on American Graffiti came out in 73.
Yeah.
And it portrays what happened in 62. It's just 11 years later. Mm-hmm. But it captured that huge change in society between the 60s and 70s. And after that, I was off to the races.
You know, you talk about a time, the 60s and 70s. American Graffiti came out in 73. I forget
right.
exactly
yeah.
The year that...
Yeah.
And why can't I think of the movie, The Girl Whose Head Spins Around?
Oh, The Exorcist.
The Exorcist.
Yeah, that was 73, that same time.
Review that movie for me now.
Scared the bejesus out of me. Scared the heck out of me.
There are times today when I will take someone that's in my age group by the M Street
the
and go
steps.
Past those steps
yeah.
and tell them, and you still get a shudder.
You know, the people bought that house, the house up at the top of the steps,
yeah.
and everybody was coming and knocking on the door going, ooh.
Yeah.
Now there's a big wall in front of the place. They had to wall the thing off to get some privacy. But I think that's great.
Art, at the top of the show, Arch, at the top of the show, I talked about your having been a colon cancer survivor.
I am a colon cancer survivor.
When did you find out you had colon cancer?
When I turned, I'm 69 years old.
Okay.
When I turned 50,
you don't
my
look a
doctor,
day over 70.
I don't feel a day over 80.
Mm-hmm.
When I turned 50, my doctor said, "Oh, you should get a colonoscopy."
Yeah.
And I said, "Yeah." So I put it off. I went back, 55, he says, here's a prescription. Go see this guy, get a colonoscopy.
Mm-hmm.
No. So I was 59. Mm-hmm. I went in there. Finally, I had like a week. I worked at Channel 4 so long, I got all this time off.
Yeah.
So I took a week, I went to the dentist, went to get a physical, and I scheduled a colonoscopy.
Mm-hmm.
And I was in there forever, and the guy calls me in. He says, you've got a tumor. And we are going to operate on you next week.
Wow.
And it wasn't just a touch of it. I had like stage 3B.
Serious stuff.
Served me right. You know, Katie Couric lost her husband to colon cancer.
Yeah.
And I hope I can say this on your show. Maybe I can get away with it. She had a colonoscopy on the air.
Right.
And I made fun of that. Mm-hmm. I thought that was hilarious. Mm-hmm. And it served me right because her doing that made it possible to talk about it.
Yeah.
So I got it and I had 6 months of chemotherapy.
Well, hold on before you go to the chemotherapy and the treatment. So you got the word.
Right.
How scared were you?
I was really scared. I started looking around. I'd go to work and think, well, this may be the last time I'm here.
Wow.
So you go home.
Really came face to face with mortality.
Well, look at my wife. I think, well, we've had a nice, how long had I been married? 10, 12 years,
yeah.
But this may be it.
Wow.
And it is amazing what people will say to you when you have cancer, and much of it doesn't help.
Like what? What did you hear?
Oh, let me tell you about the time I had chemotherapy. It was the worst thing that ever happened to me. I couldn't sleep the night before.
Wow.
I got to where I'd say, please, I
don't
want to hear your horror story. And in fact, my doctor said, beware of people with good intentions.
Uh-huh.
They want to help you,
but
They're going to make you even crazier about this.
Mm-hmm. And then
I did deal with mortality.
Did you have surgery?
Yes. I had, they have this thing called, they can do it
laparoscopic?
Yeah, mm-hmm. I had laparoscopic. So, you know, they pulled out a couple of feet.
Yeah.
I still got plenty to spare.
Mm-hmm.
Took me a couple of 3 weeks to recover. Then I started the chemo. The chemo was not pleasant, but I managed to continue to work.
Mm-hmm.
And right toward the end, it pretty much knocked me out. But That was almost 10 years ago.
Yeah.
And so I consider myself a medical miracle. And every chance I get, I like to mention to people to get a colonoscopy. And now they're not nearly as embarrassing. Mm-hmm. People get them all the time. Mm-hmm. And if they hadn't have found my tumor, I would be dead. So I came within a whisker of being too late. So I hope you get one.
Absolutely. Let me ask you.
Is that me or you?
That was you, but I think you're just fine.
What did I knock over? Oh, that's my microphone.
Did your coming to that face-to-face with that sense of mortality, again, at the top, it said, when we introduced you, it said, you know, you survived colon cancer. We're going to talk about that. We always talk about sort of what is some people have called your zeal and your commitment to give back to the community. Did the cancer experience have anything to do with that?
Yes, somewhat. Also, I'm married to a Methodist minister, mm-hmm. and that changed my life. I don't go around, preaching or proselytizing, mm-hmm. but I get a sense of what it means to really be Christian in the sense of, the world and the community. Mm-hmm. I behave myself a lot better now.
You got favorite projects?
I love the Community Foundation for Greater Washington, mm-hmm. which helps a lot of things in our city, including the House of Ruth. I'm a big supporter of the House of Ruth. Mm-hmm. I'm a big supporter of Sibley Hospital, but any hospital needs your help. And then I like small charities that help educational foundations.
Okay.
And let me also mention the Washington, D.C. International Film Festival, mm-hmm. the city's film festival. I'm on their board,
okay.
and they have been touch and go for many years, and I hope that they can continue, and anybody that can support Film Fest D.C., please do so.
Mm-hmm. Okay, let's go back to your WRC days when you guys were the rock stars.
Well, it did not happen easily, mm-hmm. and a situation like that, I don't think will. What Vance say?
Vance talked about the professionals that you guys were. He talked about George Michael, and I think it was a theme that everybody in there were really, really committed.
And everybody really respected each other.
Yeah.
So George and Vance, Ryan, me, and then at the final piece was Doreen Gensler.
Yeah.
And there we had a diverse group of professionals, mm-hmm. and we all appreciated what the others were doing.
Mm-hmm.
And we were all there for that run, that incredible run. Stations don't keep people now.
That was a time when, unlike now, when you go on the internet and you see anything you want to see, that people actually had their connections to Hollywood through the local entertainment reporter.
We were the gatekeeper.
Yeah.
Now, shall I say that that's not necessary?
Yeah.
I mean, I always figured that I was playing to those other four people, mm-hmm. that I had to keep their attention.
Mm-hmm.
So I always tried to make myself as broad as possible, you know, mm-hmm. as accessible as possible. And I figured to a large degree, I was reviewing movies and talking about things that people probably weren't even going to go see, mm-hmm. but just kind of wanted to know about, that it was part of the cultural conversation.
And so you worked with George Michael, and this movie came out with Hannibal Lecter, and George Michael had an appearance there.
Yes, he did. Well, you know, the thing is, Jonathan Demme directed Silence of the Lambs,
okay.
and Jonathan was a fan of George's Sunday night show,
uh-huh.
the George Michael Sports Machine.
Yeah.
So he knew he was going to shoot a few scenes here in the area because part of Silence of the Lamb is Clarice going through the training at Quantico.
Not just Clarice, but Clarice.
Clarice. Just try that sometime.
Oh, boy.
Sneak up behind somebody like go, Clarice. So he was in the area, and he liked George. And so he arranged to tape some stuff in the NBC building. Mm-hmm. There's a scene of the mother of the hostage that was shot in the same studio where they shoot Meet the Press over there. Mm-hmm. And then George's scene was shot on the Channel 4 news set. Mm-hmm. He played Gene Castle.
Yes.
I'm Gene Castle with sports. And but that whole thing was because Jonathan Demme liked George Michael.
And you gave it to him in a review.
I loved the movie. Uh-huh. I loved it. And it went on to win the Oscar.
Yeah.
Now, the other thing that happened with Jonathan Demme is we had a young director there who had done some small films, a guy named Jesse Vaughn. Uh-huh. And Jesse switched some of the stuff that Demme needed. And I told him, Jesse is a filmmaker. And they started talking, and he helped him leave Washington and go to California, and he is working today.
I've got to bring this personal tidbit in. I became close personal friends with a guy that had three Oscar-winning movies three different decades.
He's a friend of mine. Oh, well, I don't
One
know.
One Flew Over the Cuckoo's Nest. Mm-hmm. Amadeus.
Yeah.
And The English Patient. Saul Zance.
Oh, yeah.
What a great, great guy.
What is amazing to me is the number of young people I've met through the years who go on and go out there and have success. This kid came to visit me. He wanted to interview me for the Montgomery College newspaper. Mm-hmm. And then he says, Eduardo Sanchez is the mm-hmm. guy's name. He says, I want to make movies, and I'm going to finish up at Montgomery College. Should I go to USC, or do you think it'd be okay if I went down somewhere in Florida? I said, oh, USC for sure. Well, the guy went to Florida. And he and his friend made the Blair Witch Project.
Wow.
And they made about $20 million.
Yeah.
And he came back for interviews. And he said, remember me? I'm the guy you told not to go to Florida. But he's a nice guy. And there's a lot of stories like that.
How does one get selected to receive an Oscar award?
Well, they nominate you, and they is all the members of the Academy, and most of the members of the Academy are former winners, and they are members of that craft, too. So directors nominate directors, and for best film, all the actors and directors and technical people do the nominating. So it's crafts. It's former winners. We got a guy in town here who won the Oscar for sound on Glory and on another movie. Mm-hmm. And of course, I'm blanking on his name. Mm-hmm. But he lives right here in town, teaches at
Russell Williams.
Yeah, Russell Williams. Mm-hmm. You know him?
Mm-hmm. I don't, but the person in my ear does.
Two-time Oscar winner right here in town. Yeah. And he votes. Mm-hmm. He votes on all of it. And he's right here, and there are, you know, there are members of the Academy right here in town. It's people who have won and people in the craft unions and people who are connected. And the Oscars don't exactly reflect people's loves because mm-hmm. we all have, you yeah. know, we have different yeah. Likes, we have different agendas.
Sure. Sure.
The Oscars are one aspect of what's going on in film. Since I reviewed that movie, American Graffiti, in 1973, the culture has completely changed.
How so?
For one thing, the movies aren't as important. The movies are kind of in the same boat as television news. Mm-hmm. They're not as important now because back then, if you wanted to see American Graffiti, you had to go down to the movie theater and watch it. And if you missed it and they took it away, you didn't have a chance to see it. Now you've got DVD, you've got VCR, you've got, not VCR, but you know, you've got video, you've got on demand, and you have cable TV. And frankly, right now, much of the best work in the visual medium is being done for cable.
Marlon Brando in The Godfather.
Yo. Someday, and that day may never come, I may require a service. You know, some people say the mark of a great movie is when you can start quoting lines from it.
What would you characterize as two things? Your favorite movie of all time, and what you would say in the what you would say as a critic, the best movie.
Well, and you know, I revealed to you that when I was on Channel 4 especially, I took a broader approach than I might have personally if you and I were sitting over at some bar talking about movies.
Right.
I like stuff that doesn't do what you expect. Now, as to The Godfather, you know, people, the question always is, what's your favorite film? What's the best, what's the best film ever made?
And you mean you've been asked that before?
Some people say Casablanca.
Okay.
And that's a great movie because, you know, you're not, you don't know, and it's passed the test of time. Some people say Vertigo. I think one that really should be in there is The Godfather because I think I've watched it 100 times.
Okay.
And every time it comes on, I'll start watching and I can't put it down. I can't stop watching. The dialogue and the picture and the story and the fact that it's a three-generation movie. To make something really work, you need three generations. And then Godfather 2, and then when they put the two of them together, I know it was you, Fredo.
Yeah.
You broke my heart. You got to just love that.
That offer you can't refuse.
You know, there's hamminess, and then there's just bravado. And and it's just got, it's got it. It's got that thing. So I forget what the question was.
Did you ever? No. What do you think? What was your favorite movie, and do you identify one that you think is the best movie of all time?
Now that I have a lot of time, I'm spending a lot of time watching classic movies and watching movies that I think I liked over again. A lot of them haven't aged as well as I thought. I really like, funny, a guy was talking to me in the
I'm going to ask you one more time.
Yeah.
What's your favorite movie, and what do you think is the best?
I love a movie called The Third Man. Have you ever seen The Third Man?
I have not.
It's sometimes you can get it on Turner Classics, DVR it, watch it. It's got Orson Welles in it, Joseph Cotten. It's Vienna right after World War II. They shoot on scene. You know, the city is all bombed out. And the guy is dealing in black market medicine. And it's a love story and a mystery. And it's completely engaging, The Third Man. What's my favorite movie? The thing about that question is everybody's favorite movie changes depending on where they are in their life. And your love of a movie has to do with where you were when you saw it. And the situation when you saw it. And, you know, I remember loving movies and I remember the things that happened around it. I remember going to see an old screening of, you know, a repertoire screening of Casablanca. And we walked out of the theater and I had just gotten married and a young wife and, you know, we're all young and we're walking home, and it's kind of a fog, and it's sort of like the movie still continued. So there's a lot of movies I like.
Let me ask you, I'm not that much of a movie goer.
Well, yes, and I respect that.
Yeah.
I think people just want to know, and they go, what do you go, like once a year, twice
something
a year?
Something like that, maybe.
Yeah.
Something like that.
What was the last movie you saw?
I don't remember the last one. I really don't remember the last one. It might have been Fruitvale Station.
Uh-huh.
But Training Day with Denzel Washington. I always heard the term, two things I'll give you. They say when a person fills up a room.
Oh,
well,
yeah.
I never experienced that. What do they mean?
Yeah.
Till I met Nelson Mandela.
Yes.
And he filled up the room.
Yes.
They say that person in their acting role, they came off the screen.
Right, right.
And what does that mean?
Oh.
What it means was Denzel Washington in Training Day. He came off the screen.
Right.
What did you think
about
that?
Spoke to you. Yeah. And man, what a role for him. Because it was against type.
Yeah.
He was always a nice guy. And there he is, this fearsome guy. And he won the Oscar for it.
Absolutely.
It took me a little bit of time to adjust to him not being the nice guy anymore. Mm-hmm. But I'm the guy that says I like stuff that's different and that breaks out of the box.
Right.
And, you know, I'm there. I'm with him. I went to a thing. A guy had had written a book about the best movies about 1967 being the greatest year for movies.
Okay.
And he gave a presentation on it, and he keyed on Bonnie and Clyde, The Graduate, and In the Heat of the Night.
Mm.
And
can
first
I tell
of all,
you?
He asked us, which of those three, The Graduate, Bonnie and Clyde, or In the Heat of the Night, which one won the Oscar in 67?
Mm-hmm. You're asking me?
Yeah, it's the one it's the one I know you're going to say.
What's
your favorite of those?
I don't remember, but of course, In the Heat of the Night, one of
and
your favorite
scenes.
And
that's the one that won and he talked about this scene.
Yeah.
Go ahead.
Well, Sidney Poitier slapped the hell out of Virgil.
Right.
That's one of my favorite scenes of all time.
Right.
That was 1967.
Right. Yes.
Yes, indeed.
Audiences gasped, screamed, applauded.
Right.
It literally came off the screen.
Mm-hmm.
And the guy said, and I was so, and I want to watch that over again.
Poitier.
It made the deepest impact of anything that year, In the Heat of the Night. And there it is, surrounded by The Graduate.
Made the deepest impact of any movie, in a movie of great years.
Yes.
Why did it make such an impact?
Number one, the effect on the audience, that slap had.
Folks,
they say
tenderfoots, if you don't know what we're talking about, we're talking about Sidney Poitier playing Virgil Tibbs.
Right.
And Rod Steiger.
Right.
Playing
a redneck racist
sheriff. And Sidney Poitier was a detective coming down from New York. And
they're investigating
Virgil Tibbs.
A southern racist plantation owner.
Yeah.
And they drive up to and Tibbs has figured out, has got a clue because this guy grows orchids and he knows about orchids.
Yeah.
And of course, the sheriff doesn't.
Mm-hmm.
And the guy is the quintessential racist southern.
Yes, he is. Yes, he is.
Bigot.
And Sidney Poitier is proper Sidney Poitier, Virgil Tibbs.
Yeah.
Virgil.
And they interact, and he says something, and Sidney Poitier slaps him.
Backhanded him.
Bam!
Bam. And again.
Now that's a movie.
1967.
In 67.
Yeah.
Can you imagine?
Yeah.
Now we don't, you know, I don't see a lot of that happening today.
When you say you don't see a lot of that, are you talking about something that happens in a movie that has a cultural impact? Because that had a cultural impact.
Yes.
There was a shifting
of
what was allowable and not allowable, if you will.
And that's what I love about the movies.
what?
When they have that kind of effect, when they resonate with the culture. Now, most movies are safe. They play it safe. Mm-hmm. The bad guys are dinosaurs, or they're comic book characters.
What do you think about American Sniper?
The thing I found interesting about American Sniper is everybody could imprint their own politics on it. So you had people from the far right saying, "Yes, American Sniper. Thank you for your service. This is what it means to be an American and to go overseas." Mm-hmm. You had people on the left saying, "This guy went over there and they screwed him up." Mm-hmm. And this is what happens when you have war. Mm-hmm. I'll say this. I'm washed up anyway. I've got nothing on the line anymore. When it ended, and they showed the big parade for his funeral and all, I thought how empty the whole thing was. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. I left with a sense of sadness and emptiness for this guy. Mm. Now, a lot of people left saying, this is the true American hero, but I left.
Are you talking about a soldier? Let's talk about somebody that entertained soldiers.
What did you think?
I haven't seen it.
Oh.
Haven't seen it.
Well,
now,
there you go.
Let me ask you.
I review movies for people who don't go. But that's the thing. You know, American Sniper did manage to, and you have to salute it for worming its way into the culture.
Okay. We're talking about obviously a soldier, a lightning rod of a soldier.
Texan.
We've got pictures that we're going to show.
Uh-oh.
Of you with someone who entertained soldiers, and that was Bob Hope.
Right.
What's your reflections on Bob Hope?
I had a woman worked for me who was a whiz on the phone. And she saw that he was coming to town, and I had just taken up golf. So she got a hold of him and said, this guy wants to play golf with you. He says, okay, I'll do it Saturday afternoon before my show. Mm-hmm. And I, because I grew up in the 60s, Bob Hope was very closely allied to the Vietnam War because, you know, his career really took off in World War II, when he started entertaining the troops overseas. And he was the leading light of that. And he did it again in Korea. And then Vietnam came, and Vietnam was the first war where really the society turned against the people who went over there to fight.
Right.
If you came back to town in a uniform, you were marked. Mm-hmm. And discriminated against. Mm-hmm. So I had not thought much about him. I had not thought much of him in the 70s because of that association with Vietnam.
Sure.
Because, you know, his film career was really over. Mm-hmm. The thing about Bob Hope is, I just read a biography of him. Really, he stayed around too long. He stayed at it too long, which is one of the things that made me step away. I mean, you know, there comes a point when you want people to say, why is he still doing that? Mm-hmm. So I thought, you know, okay, yeah, well, fine, I'll play golf with Bob Hope. Yeah. He was very nice. He was very generous. He had unlimited energy. He was 85 at the time.
Wow.
And he won me over. Mm-hmm. So personally, I thought a lot of him. When he died, it is hard for people to remember how controversial he got when he was so broad before because of Vietnam. Yeah. But I had a good experience.
You ever get a chance to spend any time with Robin Williams?
I did, actually. One time, you know, he made a lot of movies that had Washington connections, and one was Patch Adams. And then he had another one after that that was produced by a guy whose family had ties to town. So they had a premiere at the Uptown Theater. Mm-hmm. And something happened. I think It was during the Clinton administration, and I think they fired missiles at Osama bin Laden in Pakistan. And they thought we were going to go to war. So I'm standing out there. There's like a dozen cameras from all the different outlets. Suddenly, they start packing up and leaving, packing up and leaving, packing up. You know, pretty soon there's six and then three. Then after a while, I'm the only guy standing there. So Robin Williams drives up in the limousine, gets out, and he does about 30 minutes because I was the only guy there. He was a complete force of nature. Mm-hmm. I don't know how he had that much energy. I understood when he died that the thought of not being able to maintain that probably depressed him. He was, all you had to do is say hello and then hold on to the microphone, and it was off to the races after that.
I asked about best movie, a favorite movie, best actor and actress.
Oh, me, that's so hard. But, you know, of course, Denzel is great. Anything he's in is great. Kevin Spacey, mm-hmm. almost anything Kevin Spacey touches now is terrific. I like what Ben Affleck is doing. I liked what he did with Argo. And, you know, did you watch Breaking Bad?
No.
Bryan Cranston. Breaking Bad gets me back to how good the material is that's coming out on cable. Mm-hmm. You could download all 60 hours of Breaking Bad and just start watching them back to back to back, and you see a heck of a story that really beautifully resolves itself. There's one other thing that kind of changed me on the way I think about movies, and that is a friend lent me the DVD of all five seasons of The Wire. Mm-hmm. So I put it in, and mm-hmm. I started watching the first episode, mm-hmm. and it went all the way to the end. And that's a novel like War and Peace.
Yeah.
And that really touches what's going on in our world and what's going on in Baltimore. So if you've got an extra 2 weeks to spend, put The Wire in. But favorite actors, there's so many good actors, but Spacey, Affleck, Denzel. I always wanted Samuel L. Jackson to play Jim Vance in a movie.
How about Samuel L. Jackson playing Marion Barry?
That would be interesting. I think, yeah, I'd love to see that.
Yeah,
I'd love to see that. I'd love to see somebody make that movie. And, you know, you hear it's happening.
Yeah.
One year I went out to the Oscars when they were still sending me to travel, and Effie was on the plane. Mm-hmm. And she was going out there to talk to somebody about the movie, maybe a movie of her life with Marion. Marion is a living Shakespearean character.
Absolutely. Anything on the horizon that
he was a chemist, you know?
Absolutely.
Nobody knows. He was a scientist.
Very short of getting his PhD.
I'm sorry.
Yeah, not a problem. On the Washington D.C. scene and as a location for movies, you see more happening?
Probably no more than is already happening. I mean, the thing I don't like about movies shot in Washington is they always use the Lincoln, the Washington, the Capitol. They show a guy going from Bethesda mm-hmm. to Silver Spring by way of the Washington Monument and the Memorial Bridge.
I've been.
You know, there's that. And then they catch the subway in Georgetown.
Yeah. I have been dying to do this. I'm going to see if you might indulge me. Can I wear your hat before the end
of the show? Oh, sure.
We've got 2 minutes.
Are you ready?
Yeah, man. We got 2 minutes.
Day I got off of TV, I wear a hat because I'm bald.
We got 2 minutes
I'm
to go.
I'm bald.
Now we got about a minute and 40 seconds to
I'm
go.
I'm bald. I left, I said, buzz it.
It's
I'm
not just sick. A bright light on your head. There's a bright future still for you. What's next for you?
I'm on the board of the DC Film Festival. I have joined a writing group in Bethesda. Mm-hmm. I am trying to write a memoir, and I want to call it The Accidental Critic. And I want to talk about television news in my day, because it's so different now. And I want to talk about the movies of the 70s, 80s, 90s, because they are so different now. And I want to talk about, I came from a very boisterous family. And I think it prepared me to work in a newsroom, especially the Channel 4 newsroom. What a pleasure to see you
Thank
again.
Thank you so very much.
So glad you have
here. Folks, when
show.
I had that hat on, I'm Arch Campbell. This wraps us up for this evening. For more information on this program or any other program produced by WHUT, go to WHUT.org. I'm Rock Newman most of the time, Arch Campbell some of the time. God bless you, and we'll see you the next time.
This program was produced by WHUT, Howard University Television, and made possible by contributions from viewers like you. Thank you.